Yes, the recording is up. Good morning, friends. Today, today is the first session of our 50 days continuous training on artificial intelligence. Initially, we would start from statistics. It would start from statistics day one, day two, day three. We shall go with statistics. Day 4 to 14, it would be in Python. And day 14, day 15 to day 29, we should go with machine learning. And from day 30 to day 40, we shall go with deep learning. From day 41, 42, we should go with natural language processing. And from day 43 to 450, we shall go with reinforcement learning of artificial intelligence. So friends, you can just join our session of all these days. It is completely absolutely free. Few friends you would have joined the session, our English sessions. You would have joined our Tamil sessions for past few months. It was completely in Tamil. It was for past 50 days. We were going with Tamil sessions. It started at October 15th and it ended at November 5th, I guess. A few people would have seen those things. So today, we would go completely with English sessions. Same thing. It would be in English. Let me just share the screen so you can have a clear vision of it. And the sessions are absolutely free. So this is our agenda. So let me just go with the basic thing. Everyone are able to see the screen, am I right?
Yes, Kalil, we do.
Yes. The trainers are myself. I'll be giving complete introduction, and Irfan, he would be taking the complete sessions. All sessions would be took by Irfan, and myself, I'm Khalil Ahmed. I was working with TCS. I came out from TCS, and others, Dinesh and Irfan, are all working professionals. And 50 online sessions we have planned for AI, machine learning, deep learning, reinforcement learning, and all these with statistics as well. So today, the session would be, that is, the today is the start date, that is November 13th, 2020. So today is the start date, and the end date would be, actually, I have mentioned as 2020, but it was a typo. It's actually 2021. It would end by Jan 2nd or 3rd, we would end up the session by Jan 2nd or 3rd. Let me just, 1 second, let me get all those other people in. If they would have joined, Oh, yes. And, it would start by, it would end by Jan 2nd. 2021, and my WhatsApp number is 9789884244. If there is any doubts, you can get back to me, to us, by WhatsApp. And also, you can, the meeting code is meeting ID is we will connect by Zoom, and meeting ID is 8301787301, and the passcode to connect is 123. That's it, and. And we are from bigdatahandson.com that I'll tell later. It's all meeting would happen on Zoom, and we would put all these videos inside our YouTube channel. Before we shall start the session, I want to what is the topic which is going to be discussed? I want to completely illustrate it. Day one, day two, day three, we would go with day one, day two, day three, it is completely statistics. First is a descriptive statistics. Day two is inferential statistics. Day three, probability distribution. Day four, day five, day four to day five, 14. Day 14 is completely with Python. Day 4, Python setup environment, Python control structures, Python data sequence type, Python list, list tuples. Day 8, sets dictionaries. Day 9, user defined built-in lambda functions. Day 10, it's iterators and generators, exception handling, everything. Like day 11, it is classes and objects. Day 12, it's inheritance. Day 13, it's modules. Modules means it's NumPy. Modules is a basic modules we would cover, database connectivity as well. And day 14 is NumPy, Matplotlib, Seaborn, and Pandas is the complete Python modules. No, inside we would go and cover. So here ends the Python part. Day 14, we have a end of Python part. From day 15, no, we start with machine learning. Day 15, we start with introduction to machine learning. Day 16, it's simple linear regression. Day 17, it's polynomial regression. Day 18, it's logistic. Day 19, it's k nearest neighbor. Day 20, it's a decision tree classifier. Day 21, it'd be random forest. Day 22, it's naive Bayes theorem. Day 23, it's SVM. Day 24, it's k-means clustering. Day 25, it's mean shift hierarchical model. Day 26, it's association rules, a priori, eclect. Day 7, it's PCA, dimensionality reduction. Day 28, it's kernel PCA. Day 29, it's model selection boost. So there ends machine learning. Day 29, we end up the machine learning at day 29. Day 30, we go with deep learning. Day introduction to deep learning. Day 31, it's CNN, convolutional neural networks. Day 32, it's recurrent neural networks. Day 33, it's ANN, artificial neural networks. All these with first day 30, day 31, day 32 is with Keras. And day 33, day 34 and day 35 is with TensorFlow. Day 35, it's recurrent neural networks. Day 36, it's auto encoder. 37, it's generative adversarial networks. Day 38, it's transfer learning. 39, it's deep learning projects, OpenCV project on day 39. Day 40, it's deep learning, that is a recommender systems. There ends deep learning part, day 40. Day 41, 42, we go with natural language processing. Day 42, it's natural language processing. We do a small project named RASA. Those two sessions is for NLP, natural language processing. Day 43, we go with reinforcement learning. Let me just invite our friends 1 second. Day 43, we go with 43, it's we enter into reinforcement learning, introduction to reinforcement learning. Day 44, it's Markov decision process. 45, it is Q learning. 46, it's a gaming project on deep convolutional Q learning. Day 47, it's a reinforcement learning on AI. Day 47, that is the A3C, we cover A3C. Day 48, we go with twin delay DDPG, we cover that. Day 49, we cover SARSA. Day 50, it's ARIMA. We cover, it's like a project, we cover in reinforcement learning. So this is our plan for all 50 days. Is there any doubts which you have in this? And all sessions are absolutely free of cost. There would be no cost or there would be no charges. Even a single penny, we doesn't charge from any of the people who's attending the sessions. And the second thing which we want to tell is the session exactly starts in Zoom exactly at 6:30 to 7:30 a.m. It starts from today and it ends at January 2nd or 3rd, 50 days when it's covered. Suppose 1 or 2 days, for example, when we executed Tamil session, 2 days, we felt ill. We was not, earphone was not feeling well. So we just postponed a section. 1 day delay was there, or 2 days delay was there in that session. So, you know, like that 2 days or 2 or 3 days, it might take as a buffer in this 50 days journey. Apart from that, absolutely all sessions would happen exactly on the stipulated time, 6:30 to 7:30. And we, if there is any disputes, we would enter inside the call, and we also will inform that the delay is 1 day delay or 2 days buffer. We need a 1 day delay or something like that, if there is anything like that. Apart from that, everything would be happening as per our plan. And any doubts you have?
Hey, Khalil, Rajesh here. First of all, thanks for giving us all these three sessions. I just want to let you know, like, is there any system requirements, or is it just only a theory sessions that you are taking up, or is it like we'll have to do some hands-on?
No, it is not possible, because all 50 sessions is from basics. Basics, you know, like, 1 second now. Let me admit. Yeah, all 50 sessions, no, it's from basic. So, you know, like, we would, you don't want to go with any prerequisites or something like that. We would inform, like, whatever which is needed, no, we would inform you people, like, whatever if it is needed, no, surely we will let you know. Or, like, as it is from basics, no, like, we would go with those. That is everything, no, we infer from initial setup, no, everything, no, we will take it forward and we will go with that. But we would show it in our system. If it is not working, then you can let us know. Like, if we have time during evening or something like that, then we will fix it up if you have any doubts setting up the environment. And apart from that, everything is available in Google. You can just download. We would provide those links and other things. Like, you yourself, like, you can just take it from Google. And also, I have sent all those syllabus in WhatsApp as well. You saw that. You should have seen that. No, like, you can get all those 50 days syllabus which I have read out in WhatsApp. It is in WhatsApp. Like, you can take it from there. Any other doubts apart from this? Shall we move on to the session? Any doubts? No, I guess, right? No. Okay. I'm assuming that everything is fine, and there is no doubts from here. So let me just shortly, you know, let me go with our YouTube channel before we shall start the session. We are bigdatahandson.com. Like, whatever sessions which we take here, you know, everything will be recorded here and it will be posted in our channel, bigdatahandson.com. So you can just see all those videos, see all those in Tamil we have done, and those 50 sessions we have done it in Tamil. So you can watch those session exactly in Tamil. Like, you can see that day one, day two, day three, everything would have took in Tamil. So now it's an English thing, English version, which you take. And this is a complete English, wherein people globally know they can and make use of it. So this is the last series was in Tamil. So it was completely a 50 days. So part 1, part 2, part 3 was in statistics. Part 4 to part 14 was in Python. Part 15, we started with machine learning. And we ended with part 29. We ended with machine learning. Then part 30, we started with deep learning. And we ended with part 40. Deep learning was ended. 41, 42, we gone with natural language processing. 41, 43, we gone with reinforcement learning. And we ended up at part 50 with reinforcement learning, ARIMA, SARSA. But everything was in Tamil. But now we go with English version, because we had lots of requests from people that we want to go with English. So we started with English now. And before we shall start the session, no, like, I want to give my introduction of the website. And, you know, like, be your big data hands-on.com. So we are bigdatahandson.com. We operate in Trichy and also in Chennai as well. Due to COVID, we completely changed our practice to online sessions. So now we completely are into online modes. It's 978-988-4224 is our support number. And if you want to go with seeing our videos, you can go to menus. Meetup uploads, you can see meetup videos and you can click on it and you can see our, it entered into blogs, meetup uploads, meetup videos, you can see our videos. I guess it's slow now. Fine. You can see there, slowly it will get loaded. You can see that. And if you want to see about us, you can again go here and you can watch about if you want to read about us, you can just have a look of about me. It's a complete small brief introduction on me, bigdatahandson.com. You can see that about us from here. That's it. So we shall go with the session now. Irfan on can you introduce yourself now?
Yeah. So myself, Muhammad Irfan. I am taking this sessions 1 year. And now we are taking as 50 day sessions. Before we started as 1 week. Now we end up with a 50 day session. Okay, so now I will share my screen. Okay, hope you all see my screen. So before starting that, can anyone tell me what is artificial intelligence and why we are in this nowadays? It is very famous, artificial intelligence. So can anyone tell me that? Okay, I will tell you that. So artificial intelligence is performing a human decision making. It's simply we can say how humans are making decisions. The same way we are training the computer to make decisions. Okay. And why it is so famous is because on every industries, they are moving on to the artificial intelligence to develop their sales or whatever it is. They are moving on to the artificial intelligence. That's why nowadays it is more demand for the artificial intelligence researchers. And to explain the artificial intelligence, we can compare the computer as a newborn baby. Okay, so newborn baby don't knows anything. Okay, the same way the computer also performing. So initially we will say some commands to do what to do, the computer will do. Okay, and we are in the early days we are training our brain. So with the datas, what are the datas? We are observing the environment, so that is the data for our brain. So what we are hearing and what we are seeing, the same way we provide some datas to our computer to train. Okay, and we are making decisions with respect to the previous experience. Okay, so previous what we have done, the same way if we face the problem, we can solve because we already know how to solve this. Okay, and to explain this, we can take ourselves, the humans. If you are seeing a new object, what we will ask, what is the name of this object, and we will observe the shape and observe the colors. So these are the characteristics of the object. So the characteristics of the object are the data for the of data we will collect from the object. Okay, so after that, whenever we are seeing an object, we can classify what is that object. If you are seeing an apple or a fruit, so we can determine the color. If the color is red, it can be apple. Okay, so the shape itself, like an apple, we can say, we can classify as an apple. If that is color is an orange, we can say the fruit is orange. So like that, we are classifying. No, so the same way we will train this computer to classify the things. Okay, so simply that is the artificial intelligence. Okay, now we'll see the explanation about the AI. So AI can have two purposes. One is to use the power of computers to augment human thinking. So like I said before, so just as we use motors to augment human or horsepower, okay, robotics and expert systems are major branches of that. The other is to use a computer's artificial intelligence to understand how humans think. Okay, and all the artificial intelligence algorithms are working as an our human brain. Okay, so in the sub branches of artificial intelligence, you will see machine learning and deep learning. So in the deep learning, we depict our human brain by the neural networks. Okay, so it works how our human brains are working. Okay, so if you test your programs not merely by what they can accomplish, but how they accomplish it, okay, there you are really doing cognitive science. You are using AI to understand the human brain, human mind. Okay, and now goals of artificial intelligence. So what is the uses of artificial intelligence? And in artificial intelligence, we create the intelligent robots to handle the tasks as an object manipulation and navigation and the prediction of the future. So for example, if you take the COVID-19 example, so the AI researchers are trying to predict how many days COVID-19 will extend. Okay, so that time we use the artificial intelligence to predict the future, so what will be happen. Okay, and for game playing, we know that artificial intelligence are used for game playing, like bots. We can say these bots are playing the human games like chess or whatever the video games are. We can train our computer to play the game. Okay, and the learning systems have the ability to extend their knowledge based on the accumulated experience. So the experience is nothing but the data, so which we provide, that is an experience for this algorithms. Okay, now we will see the data science. So the data science will cover all these things. Okay, so data science is nothing but the study of the data. So initially, for training an artificial intelligence algorithm, we provided the data. Okay, so that data we need to analyze or we need to know what is the data is about. Okay, so that time we use data science. Okay, so data science will cover all the parts of like artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, not only the data analysis and data pre-processing. So we will provide a prediction on data science also. Okay, so predictions using this algorithms, artificial intelligence, machine learning or deep learning. Okay, so this data science is all about the data. So we are in this world nowadays, we are having like tons of data we have. Okay, so that is called big data, we know that. Okay, so this big data also we can handle with the data science. So data science, if you see this image, we will understand like visualizing, data pre-processing, data mining and AI, all this and the statistics, all this includes on the data science. So it's just like an area that manages, manipulates, extracts and interprets knowledge from tremendous amount of data. Tremendous amount of data is nothing but the big data. Okay, and data science is a multidisciplinary field of study with goal to address the challenges on in big data. Okay, not only the big data, we can apply this data science to the small data also. Okay, so in the data science to do, we need two things. We need to know two things important, very very important. That is mathematics, and another one is any one of the computer language or programming language we need to know. So in these sessions we will cover with Python. So don't worry about the Python. We are having we know that 10 sessions are we will have Python sessions. So don't worry about that. And first thing, we need to know the mathematics behind the artificial intelligence. Okay, so why we need mathematics is because all these algorithms in artificial intelligence are derived from mathematics, mathematical equations only. So we need to know like majorly in mathematics, we need to know statistics and probability. These two are very very important, statistics and probability. Why is because in using this statistics and probability only, we will predict the futures. So that's why it is important. And we need to know the matrix, of course, matrix and calculus. So these are the important topics on mathematics, which we will cover this session, no problem. So first, today we will cover statistics because it is very very important. That's why we will cover statistics today's session. Okay, and so statistics we will cover today. Now we will move on to the statistics. Okay, so what is statistics? Statistics is the science of data. Okay, so all the operations in the data science are done by the statistical equations only, statistical analysis we can say. Okay, so statistics is the science of data. It involves collecting, classifying, summarizing, organizing, analyzing and interpreting data. So collecting means the data which we will cover from the survey or whatever it is. So that's the first step of the statistics. So we will collect the data and classify, summarize. So all this thing we will cover today, no problem. And statistical analysis, so used to manipulate, summarize and investigate data so that useful decisions making information results. So it's nothing but like using this data, so collected data, we will draw some inferences about the data. So on prediction also we will do using this statistical analysis. Okay, so in statistics we have two types. One is descriptive statistics, another one is inferential statistics. So today we will see the only the descriptive statistics only. So in descriptive statistics is nothing but it involves collecting the data, presenting the data and categorizing the data. So these are under descriptive statistics. And inferential statistics, we will see estimation and hypothesis testing. These are some testing like drawing inferences about the data. Okay, that's the hypothesis testing and estimation we will do. And the purpose of the descriptive statistics is to describe the data. That's it. So simply we can say to descriptive statistics is used for describe the data. And for purpose of this inferential statistics is make decision about population characteristics. So don't worry about this letters like population characteristics. So we'll see about the population sample. So letters slides we will see. Okay, and for example, for the descriptive statistics, to describe the data, what we can do, we can put some tables and graphs to visualize the data, and easily we can understand the data. If we are seeing this type of data, if I show you this one, so initially no one should understand this, what about this data, what the data is about. Okay, so we cannot understand this type of data, like characteristic, bunch of characters and numbers are there, so we cannot understand. So that's why the descriptive statistics is used for, so to describe and easily we can understand using the graphs. Okay, graphs or summarization tools, we can understand the data better. Okay, so if I show you this one, if I show you this graph, is made with this data only. Okay, so initially seeing this data you cannot understand. So now if I show you this graph, you may understand, because it's just a simple one, like survived and the count of the survived people. So count of passengers who survived. So this is a Titanic data. Okay, Titanic data. So the passengers are traveled on the Titanic ship. So that's the data. And in this graph is about the survived of the passengers who survived. Okay, so easily we can see like more than 500 are not survived on the Titanic ship, and nearly 3,500 people are survived on the ship. So using these graphs we can easily understand, the data. So that's what the descriptive statistics about, is about. And now if I show you this data, the data as a table, like these tables you are seeing, no, this is a table. So all these columns, these are columns and these are rows. Okay, so these are rows and these are columns. So all these columns are a characteristics, okay, characteristics of this data. Okay, all these columns, like passenger ID, survived, passenger class, name, sex, age, siblings, and ticket fare, these are all the characteristics of this data. Okay, so all this data, if you observe the data which provided here are not the same type. Okay, so these are the different types, these are some characters and these are some decimal values, like this. Okay, so all the data are provided is not the same type, it has the different types. So that means the data we are getting, no, it has various types and various forms. Forms means like you can have images as your data, you can have text as your data, you may have a voice sounds, no, that we can also provide as a data. So these are all the forms of data. So the types of data means like if I ask your name, you will say my name is Muhammad Irfan or whatever. Okay, so the names you are saying, no, that is not a integer, that is only A to Z characters. Okay, so that is the type of data. Okay, so the name of the name is the one of the type of your data. And if I ask your age, okay, so your age will be see like 27, 25, 60 maybe. Okay, so if you say your age as minus 10, minus 20, no. Okay, so no, we cannot say your age as your negative values. It cannot contain negative values, right? The age will not contain negative values, only positive, and the positive should be a whole number. So you cannot say your age as 27.5. So that is a decimal numbers, no. Okay, so the age should be a whole number, not the decimal numbers. If I ask your height and weight, height and weights are decimal numbers, so we know that. Okay, so these are the types of the data. So in statistics they are saying we have two types of data. Wait, one is qualitative and another one is quantitative. In the qualitative and quantitative we have subdivisions over there. So first we will see the what is qualitative data is. So qualitative data are measurements that each fall into one several categories. So the categories like hair color, black, brown, or this colors, no, colors are one the categories, and ethnic groups and other attributes of the population. So the groups and classes we have, no, that is a qualitative data. So if you have the categories on your data set, that will be qualitative data. For example, if I show you in this data set, what are the qualitative data? If I want to tell you the survived, the class survived column, if you see, we have only two class. All these data are only labeled as 0 or 1. Okay, this is the qualitative data. So we have two classes. One is 0 and another one is 1. Okay, so that is qualitative data. And another for example is passenger class. So passenger class, we have three classes. You can see here 1, 2, and 3. Okay, so that also qualitative data. And the sex, and we have two types of gender. One is male and female. Okay, only we have male and female. So that's the qualitative data. So that means we have each fall into one several categories. Okay, so it is a qualitative data. And quantitative data, for example, that are observations that are measured on a numerical scale. So in this data, you are seeing as a numerical, like age is one quantitative data, and far is gonna quantitative data. Okay, and in these two types also we have subdivisions. In qualitative data, in qualitative data itself we have two types. One is diatomic and another one is polynomic. So diatomic, it takes the form of a word with two options. So the example is gender provided here, male or female. So only two labels provided in the data, that will be diatomic type. So here the survival class also a diatomic type because it has only two labels, 0 and 1. Okay, and polynomic, it takes the form of a word. More than two means that will be polynomic. So more than two here, the passenger class will be polynomic because that is the classes are provided are more than two. Okay, so it's a polynomic. It takes the form of a word with more than two options. So for example, here given types of car. So Hyundai, Maruti, Audi, Benz, etc. Okay, that is qualitative data on the type diatomic and polynomic. So again, diatomic only has two labels, okay, that will be diatomic, and more than two labels, that will be polynomic. Okay, okay. So and in quantitative data also we have two types, discrete and continuous. Okay, so discrete will be a countable one. Okay, so it, you can count easily, or we can say the discrete data set is like a whole numbers. Okay, whole numbers means you cannot have decimal numbers. Or continuous, we can say the decimal numbers. Okay, so simply discrete is a whole number, continuous data set is a decimal numbers. Okay, so it says like it is the result of counting. It's the result of counting the number of employees. Examples, the number of employees in an organization, or the number of books on a shelf. So the examples of the discrete data type. And for continuous data type, it says it is the result of measuring like distance traveled or weight of luggage, or you can say our height. Height also continuous data. Okay, so the, for example, here the age and the fare are the continuous data. Okay, and this one also, the passenger ID also continuous data. So it is keep on increasing, no, the values keep on increasing. So that's the continuous data types. So why we are seeing this is because we are classifying our characteristics of the data with the data types. It's because in the pre-processing steps we need to know the type of the data. That's because if I see this type of data, we have categories, no? So all these categories of data we need to make as a numerical one. So this is a pre-processing steps we will cover. It's because all these algorithms, no, artificial intelligence algorithms, are only based on the mathematical equations. So we cannot have this type of characters. So is you can multiply the male with 3, No, we cannot multiply the characters. No, multiply with the numbers. We cannot do that. So that's why this type of data needs to be converted on converted to the numerical one. So that time we need to know the type of the data. So that's why we are seeing this all this qualitative, quantitative data types. And this is the whole thing which we see here, types of variables. So the variables is nothing but the columns. The columns provided here, no? You can call these columns as a variables also. We can call this as a variables or characteristics. We can say, yeah, okay. Thus here they are saying variables, okay. So the columns are nothing but the variables. So the variables, it can be qualitative or quantitative. And in qualitative, we have two types, diatomic, polynomial, which we see already. And quantitative data, we have two types, discrete and continuous. The examples of these types. So diatomic for gender and marital status, and polynomic examples are brand of car and hair color. Discrete type of examples are children in family, strokes on a golf hole. And the continuous data type examples are amount of income tax paid, weight of a student. Okay. So now we all clear with the data types. Now we'll go with numerical scales of measurement. So the scales of measurements are included with the nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio. So the scale determines the amount of information contained in the data. Okay. The scale we need to know. So this variable, let's say the passenger ID. The passenger ID, what the scale is belongs to. So then or passenger class or survived, what the scales these data are. Okay. So the scale in this indicates the data summarization and statistical analysis that are appropriate. So for the summarization or statistical analysis we do. So when we need to do the summarization or the statistical analysis of this variable, this type of variables on this scale. Okay. So that time we need to know the scales of this measurement. Okay. So we have four types, no, like nominal, ordinal, and interval ratio. So first we will see the nominal data. So the nominal data, we can categorize these two, like nominal and ordinal, as the categorical type of data. We use this nominal and ordinal measurements for the categorical type of data, and interval and ratio, these measurements we use for the continuous or the quantitative data. So for quantitative data, we use these two type of measurements, okay? And for qualitative, we use nominal and ordinal. So for nominal scale of measurements, it says data are labels or names used to identify an attribute of this element. Okay, so the nominal data, I said before, and the nominal and ordinal are provided with the categorical type of data. That means qualitative data. So in that qualitative data, nominal says nominal is the categories which we use in the variable that are not that can be sorted, or you can say we cannot put in a order. Okay, so if I say the male and female, we cannot put an order like male should be first or female should be first. Okay, so all this type of nominal data, it has no the order. It has no order, like for example, the hair color, brown, black, blonde, gray, other. So we cannot order this hair color, no. So that's what the nominal data is, okay? And for example, here the data are like this sex column, and this column only, that is using the measurement of nominal scale. This is a nominal scale. And another scale is ordinal. So ordinal data is like, it should be ordered one. That's the name itself, the ordinal, no? So it should be the ordered data. Like for example, here, how do you feel today? It says very unhappy, unhappy, okay, happy, or very happy. So it can be like order, no? It can be order, like from negative to positive, we can say, okay? So on this right hand side, we have how satisfied are you with our service? Very unsatisfied, somewhat unsatisfied, neutral, somewhat satisfied, or very satisfied. It can be ordered one, okay? So that's the data, that's the measurement of scales, the ordinal scales, it can be ordered one, okay? Okay, now let's see the next type, that is interval. So the interval type of scales of measurement we use for the numerical data. So in the numerical data have properties of ordinal data, and the interval between observation is expressed in terms of a fixed unit of measure. That means it increase by a value. For example, if I say this data, the passenger ID. So if you see the passenger ID, it keep on increasing with the value of 1. So we are increasing as 1, 1 plus 1, 2, 2 plus 1, 3, 3 plus 1, 4. So this is the measurement of what? The interval. It's because the interval between the 5 to 6 is the same as interval between 2 to 3. 1 is the difference, no? So the 2 to 3 difference is 1, the same as 5 to 6 difference, that is 1, okay? This is the scale of measurement interval. It is okay. It says the classic example of an interval scale is Celsius temperature, because the difference between each value is the same. For example, the difference between 60 and 50 degree is the same. The 50 and 60 degree is measurable as 10 degrees. No, is the same as 80 to 70 degrees. It's okay. And one more thing, in interval scale of measurement, we don't have any true zero value. Okay, we don't have true zero. It says like true zero. Okay, for example, there is no such thing as no temperature. We cannot say no temperature. Is we can say no. We cannot say no temperature. It should be a temperature, at least not with Celsius. In the case of interval scale, zero doesn't mean the absence of value. Okay, so if you say the interval is zero, it's not mean the value is not present, value is absence, okay? But it's actually another number used on the scale, like 0 degrees Celsius, okay? So for the zero value, we have use that is 0 degrees Celsius. For example, in the Celsius degree, we have 0 degrees Celsius, no? And that's what it is. And the last scale of measurement, that is ratio. It has the same properties of interval, but it is something like difference between interval and ratio. It's because the interval cannot contain a zero value, but this ratio can contain a zero value. Okay, the scale must contain a zero value that indicates that nothing exists for the variable at the zero point. So for the ratio, we can contain a zero value. So the variables such as distance, height, weight, and time use the ratio scale, okay? Okay, so these are the measurements of scales. And now we are entering into the descriptive statistics type. So we know that in statistics, we have two types, descriptive and inferential statistics. Now we are entering into a descriptive statistics, okay? So in descriptive statistics, we have three steps. One is collect data. The example is survey, and the presenting the data with use of the graphs and tables, and summarization of the data. The example is the sample mean. So mean is the summarization technique for the, okay. So in this descriptive statistics, one by one we will see. So first we will see the collecting the data, and then the next we will see presenting the data and summarizing the data, okay. So on this collecting the data, it means to do the statistical analysis on this type of data. For example, to do the statistical analysis, on the Titanic data. So we need the data, right? So we need to collect the data somewhat. It is okay. Somewhere we need to collect. So using the methods like survey, so we can take the survey and collect the data. So in the data, the two terms will come. One is population and another one is sample. So some people are confused with this two terms, population and sample. So population data is like the whole data. If I say the students in the university are the population data, okay? So from the students, a sample data are collected, okay? That is the that means if you have 10,000 students on the university, we'll take like nearly like 2,000 students for the survey. So that is the sample data. The 2,000 students are there, no? That is the sample one. Okay, so the population means the whole data, that means the whole students in the university, and the sample is taken with the population as 2,000. Okay, so randomly we will choose some students, or the, for choosing the data, no, we have various methods on the collecting the data itself. Okay, so on choosing the data means we have two methods, biased sampling and unbiased sampling. We will see that. And first problem, a statistician face how to obtain the data. So first step is the initially we need the data to do the statistical analysis. So to obtain the data is the first problem the statistician faces. Okay, and it is important to obtain good or representative data. Good or representative data, how you can say the data is good or representative, is because we can say the sample data are good and representative. The sample data should be represent the population data. That means the whole, the 10,000 students are, we are collecting from the 2,000 students, no? So the 2,000 students will represent the 10,000 students. That what is the good and representative sampling is, okay? And inferences are made based on statistics obtained from the data. That means the inferences we will do with only the sample data, okay? So someone asked this question. This data collection will be done with data science or it's a part of AI? So it's a part of data science. Okay, so data science means all these things like collecting the data, summarizing, organizing, and visualizing. So all these techniques we will under the data science. And after this, like pre-processing the data, we'll go with the artificial intelligence algorithms. Because in artificial intelligence algorithm, we need to provide the data. Where we will provide from collecting and the, all these things, the pre-processing steps are done. Then only we will give this data to the artificial intelligence algorithm to train on the data, okay? So I hope I explained your doubt, I think, okay. And inferences can only be as good as the data. So if the sample data is good, then only the inferences will be good, okay? So that's what this line says. And for sampling techniques, we have two methods, biased sampling and unbiased samplings. So biased samplings, we don't often do because it is only the convenient data we will collect in the biased sampling method. In biased unbiased sampling method, will cover all the data, all the population data will cover, but in biased sampling we don't, okay? So a biased sampling method, a sampling method that produces the data which systematically differ from the sampled population, okay? That's biased sampling data. And unbiased sampling method is one that is not biased. So the meaning of the biased means the convenient to us. Let's say I am taking a survey on the university. So I will, you cannot survey all the students, all the 10,000 students. That will be time consuming and cost efficient. So that's why we'll take some students. let's say on biased sampling, if I want to say, I'm only taking the survey on the canteen. Okay, I'm going to the canteen. I'm seeing the students and taking them survey. Okay, only I'm taking in the canteen. So let's say the 1,000 students are in the canteen and all the other students are in the classes. Okay, so that means I'm not taking the students who are in the classes. I'm only taking in the canteen only. So it may be in chances of losing the data because from the university or the students in the classes, that may be can be a good samples. Okay, so that's why the biased sampling is not like we often do. Okay, so in some biased sampling method, it has also two types. One is convenience sample and another one is volunteer sample. Okay, convenience samples are selected from elements of a population that are easily accessible. Convenience sample, the examples I said before, no, the canteen example, this is the example for convenience example, convenience sample method. Okay, I'm only taking near to me. So I'm in the canteen, I'm only taking the survey on this canteen only, okay, not the whole classes. So that is a convenience sample. And another one is volunteer sample. So volunteer samples are the students who are voluntarily part of this survey. So that will be volunteer sample, the sample collected from those elements of the population which choose to contribute the needed information on their own initiative. Okay, on their own they are coming to the survey. That means that is the volunteer sample. So these two type of the sampling method are biased samplings. Okay, for unbiased sampling we have random sampling methods. So the random samples method are a type of unbiased sampling is because in the random samples, all the populations data have the same chance to be chosen for the sample data. That means on the university we have 10,000 students. All the 10,000 students have the same probability to be chosen for the survey. Okay, so if I'm taking the 1,000 students for the survey, that means the 10,000, all the 10,000 students have the same chance to be in a part of this survey. Okay, so this is a method of random sample. The sample, because we are taking as random, so that means all the population data has the same probability, right? A sample selected in such a way that every element in the population has a equal probability of being chosen. That's what I said. Equivalently, all samples of size n have an equal chance of being selected. Random samples are obtained either by sampling with replacement from a finite population or by sampling without replacement from an infinite population. So for taking this random samples, we can use random generated numbers or we can use some number tables to choose the samples. So for example, we are saying an employee is interested in the time it takes each employee to commute to work each morning. A random sample of 35 employees will be selected and their commuting time will be recorded. Okay, so we are taking 35 samples or the employees. The employee, there are 2,712 employers. So from these 2,712 employers, we are taking only 35. Okay, so we can number the each employee. So this is the one method for a random sample that will be each employee is numbered like 1, 2, 3, 4 like that, and the 4-digit number because it has 4-digit 2712. So and then using the 4-digit random numbers, so we'll generate the random numbers 4-digit and then we will select some samples, right? So we'll select 32 employees over the 2712 employees. So the sample is identified, the number are 1315, so like this. Okay, so like that we will randomly choose the samples over the population. Okay, so this is one technique for random samples for unbiased sampling. And another technique for unbiased sampling is systematic sample. and stratified random sample. Another new is cluster sample. These three we will see one by one. So systematic samples. So systematic sample, a sample in which every kth item of the sampling frame is selected. That means like if you have 10 students, let's say, I'm in the systematic sample, what will we have? Like first we will take the first student one and increase by the one, increase by one or two, let's say two. Okay, so if I increase by two, then that will be third student. Okay, so one first student, third student, fifth student, seventh student, ninth student. Okay, so this is the systematic samples. So we are choosing the kth item from the sample frame. So that's what it is. Okay, that's the systematic sample. Another one is stratified random sample. So in the stratified random sample, what we will do, let's say in the stratified, let's say you are taking a survey, male and female, or like 1,000 peoples are there. So if I say male or female are there, and in stratified random sample, what we will do, first we will group the people. So male will be on one side and female will be one side. So we are grouping into the categories. Okay, so from these categories we will take random samples. That's the stratified random samples. And it is different from the cluster samples because the cluster sample is different, the same as stratified random sample, but a little bit different from the stratified random sample. In the cluster sample, what we will do, instead of separating the categories like male and female, we will separate as groups. Groups is like let's say I'm grouping on five groups. Okay, so if I'm taking five groups, in all the groups we will have both male and female, both categories we will have on the same group. Okay, but in the stratified random sample we don't have, we will separating as the categories, using the categories. But in cluster sample it's not the same, because on every group in the cluster sample have all the datas like male or female. Okay, so this is the cluster sample, and then the same thing, randomly we will pick the datas, okay, from the clusters. Okay, the difference between the stratified sampling and cluster sampling. Stratified sampling, the difference between stratified and cluster sampling can be drawn clearly in the following grounds. The probability sampling procedures in which the population is separated into different homogeneous segments called strata, that is the term we use for separating the classes, strata, and then the sample is chosen from the each stratum randomly, is called stratified sampling. On other hand, the cluster sampling, for example, the researcher wants to survey academic performance of high school students in Spain, he can divide the entire population into different clusters. So the whole population we divide in the clusters. Okay, so the clusters, and then the researcher selects a number of clusters depending on his research through, for example, 5 or 3, whatever. Okay, through simple or systematic random sampling. That's it. So that's the stratified and cluster samplings. Now we'll complete the collection of data. So now we collected the data. So now what? So now we need to present and organize the data. That means we need to visualize the data and understand what the data is about. So that's the part of it, the present or organize the data. So in the presentation of this data, we'll like types of descriptive statistics, organize data. In the organized data, we use tables and graphs. Okay, so tables are frequency distributions and relative frequency distributions. These are the tables, and graphs are bar chart, histogram, you know, that pie chart, frequency polygon. These are the graphs we can visualize. These are the tables. Okay, so the goal of this organization of data and presentation of data is to about understand the data clearly. Okay, so initially I shown you the, like, if you see like this data, you may not understand. So if you see like this tables and graphs, we can easily understand the data is about. Okay, so that's why the organization the data is. And so let's see the one by one, first we will see the frequency distribution table. So this distribution of the data which describe how often each value appears. That means in the frequency distribution, what we'll do on the data sets, for example, the subjects, let's say sociology, anthology, other in the psychology, these are the subjects. Okay, so in the frequency distribution, what we'll do, sociology, let's say, so how many students are picked the sociology subject. Okay, so this number of students are picked, here we will see, you can see this is the data and this is the frequency distribution table. So psychology students are 62, economy students are 35. So that's why we are counting each category. Okay, so psychology students means how many students are picked the psychology subject. So that's what the frequency distribution is about. And for example, here we already put the frequency distribution table here. So you can see these two are the frequency distribution table. So here what I'm trying to do is I need to count how many passengers are not survived, how many passengers are survived. So I'm taking the frequency distribution table for that. Okay, so first I will just explain this code a little bit, because we don't worry about these codes, because later on this session we will see clearly on what is what. Okay, and this environment is like is very very useful and free of cost, because if you have a Google account and if you have a drive, that's it, no problem. We can code without any software also. It's because just go to your drive and then here new button will appear. No, so here if you click on this, in the last we have a more button. So in this more button you can see Google Collaboratory. So initially for some users you cannot see this Google Collaboratory here. So if you don't see this, you can connect the app. Okay, so this is created by the Google developers, and you can connect this Google Collaboratory with this button, connect more apps. If you click the connect more apps button, it will appear a window. On this you can search the Google Collaboratory here. Just type collaboratory collaboratory here, right? So it will appear in this collaboratory. Okay, so here if you click you will see install for maybe in your system you will see install, because I'm seeing uninstalled because I have already installed here. So just click on the install button and that's it. And next time if you go to the more option, you may see the Google Collaboratory, and just click on this Google Collaboratory, it will create a new notebook for you and you can start typing your codes. Okay, and for this data, don't worry about this data, I will tell you the resources for that. So all these data which I am using on these sessions are taken in the taken from the Kaggle. So it is again it is free of cost. Just go to the Kaggle. In Kaggle website you will see lots of data sets are available there, so you can download the data sets and use it for your whatever you want, like. Okay, so there are a bunch of data are available is there. I am using the Titanic data, you can also find it here, like type Titanic and you will find the data set. So the same data set I'm using, what this one, test Titanic or train Titanic. So if you see here, passenger ID, survived, all these columns we already seen here. So the same data is here, so you can download and use it for your whatever the statistical probability or predictions. Okay, so now after coming to this this environment, the Google Collaboratory, so first thing first, you need to connect this environment, so to the runtime. So here you can see in the right hand side top, you may see the connect button. So just click on this, it will connect to the runtime, and then you can start typing your codes. Okay. And don't worry about this code. Like I will explain this on the later sessions, but now the concept is important because the time is nearly 7:41. So we need to complete this one. Maybe at least the organize and summarize the data. Okay. So we'll complete from the organize and summarize data. Okay. So after this, you need to connect to this Google Drive, because the data comes from the drive. Okay. So you need to download this data set and put in your drive. So if you see here, I have this data sets, books.csv like that. Okay. So and then you can access the file from the Google Drive. Okay. So now it's the one way. And another way of accessing the file is with this. Like if you click on the folder like button here on the left hand side, and here you can see the upload file. Okay. So in the upload file, just select the file you want and then open. Okay. So it will okay, so now you can see this file here. Just copy the path and then put here pd.read.csv. So the pandas library we'll use for the data manipulation. So we are just reading on the CSV file. Just run this and that's it. You will get the data. And now run this data.head of 10. So this will be used for seeing the head values. Means starting 10 values. Okay. And then the dist plot over the age, the distribution of this age, you can see here. So the distribution. So that means here, if you see the 20 and between 20 to 40 that are increased, no. So that means from between 20 to 40 age. Okay. So the passengers are traveled more between 20 to 40 age. Okay. So this graphs is telling about, and this scatter plot of this age. So it is the it's the bar chart, or you can see histogram. This is a scatter plot. So first what we can do, I will just explain all the types of the tables and graph visualization techniques, and then we will see the implementation. Okay. So frequency distribution table we already seen here. So I will show you this one. Okay. This is the frequency distribution table. That means it is counting the labels. So in this column, if you have two labels, that is 0 and 1, so it is just counting how many zeros are there. Okay, how many ones are there. So that's the frequency distribution table is about. And relative frequency distribution table is nothing but the percentages of these frequencies. So it's like over the population, the total number of students are 183. Okay, so the percentage of the students, psychological students, that are 33.9%. So there's the same way we will calculate the percentages for the for every classes. Okay, economy, sociology, anthropology, and other. Okay, over the population. So 183 is the population, and over this 62 are psychological student. The percentage of the students are 33.9. That is the relative frequency distribution. Simply that is. Okay. Okay, so now then we have the graphical techniques like bar chart, histogram, pie chart are the graphical technique to visualize the data. So first we will see histogram. So bar chart and histogram are look like the same, but it is different. Okay, so first we will see bar charts. Okay, so these are the bar chart. You see this image. This one is the bar chart. Okay. So in the bar chart, it has some identicals, like each distinct value is represented by a bar. That means for each labels, we can say for each label we will have one bar. Okay, so for one first label we have one bar, second label we have another bar, third label we have another bar. Okay, so for each distinct value is represented by a bar. This is the first identical of bar chart. And and the category axis is not linear. That means the distance of these bars you may see the same as the difference between other bars. So the distance is the same, and the size, the width of these bars are the same. So that's the second part. Second point is it, and zero frequencies are omitted. Third point. That means if you have a zero frequency, means zero count that are omitted. Okay, in the bar chart. And the fourth point is none of these features hold for a histogram. So I said before, like bar chart is different from histogram. So the characteristics of this bar chart may not available in the histogram. It's the opposite of bar chart. Okay, so in the histogram, if you see, the bars are not equal. So in the right hand side, that is histogram, left hand side, it is the bar chart. The bars are equal in the bar chart, and the bars of width of these bars are not equal. Okay, are not equal in the histogram. And and the spaces between the bars is not available in the histogram. Okay, histogram is a graphic representation of frequency distribution with class intervals or attributes as the base and frequency as the height. Okay, the key difference is the histograms have bars without any spaces between them. So like this image you may see, the between the spaces is not available between the bars, and the rectangles need not to be equal width. Okay, the width of these bars are different from others. Okay, so that's the difference between histogram and bar chart. To create histograms and bar chart in Python coding, it is very simple. Like factor plot you can use for bar chart. So the bar chart represents two classes, one is 0 and 1, the y variable as the frequency, that means the count. Okay, so these two lines, simply from the two lines we can create a bar chart. And this catplot also the same as the bar chart, it's just you can visualize multiple classes. Okay, so for example, male, how many male passengers are survived or not survived, how many female passengers are survived or not survived, so that we can see using the catplot. Okay, and on for the passenger class also I have done this one. So for class 1, class 2, class 3 passengers, so in this graph you can understand easily, like the passenger class, third class passengers are more affected, means more passengers are died in the third class only. Okay, and from the first class we can understand that more people on the first class are survived. Okay, and for the histogram, that is simple, plt.hist. okay, so just hist and plt dot the matplotlib library, using the plt dot hist also we can create histogram. And using this seaborn library dist plot, you have already seen, no, using this also we can create the histograms. Okay, so histogram is really easy. So plt dot hist, and we need to provide the data. So this graphs is about like we have two classes, one is male and female. For two classes, let's say male. Okay, so male passengers, so in the male passengers, between, I said before, like 20 to 40 passengers are there in the more in the data. And in the 20 to 40 passengers are what survive. Okay, more survived in the Titanic ship. And the females also nearly to the 25 to 35 age. aged females are more survived. Okay. Okay. So this is what the histogram and bar chart is about. And so the difference between the bar chart and histogram, the parameter, the definition of the bar chart are pictorially represented in the form of spaced bars with debit numerical data. Okay. And histogram, the graphical representation in the form of bars with no spaces between them, debit frequency distributions. And the type of data of bar chart are categorical, or histogram of type is quantitative data. Okay. And the spaces is in the bar chart, we have equal spaced bars, and histograms, we no space between the bars. And the width of the bars of the bar chart is equal width, and histograms width may vary. Okay. And now we have another graphical representation, that is pie chart. So pie chart we used when you are trying to compare one part of the population over the population. So pie chart are best to use when you are trying to compare parts of a whole. They do not show the changes over time. Okay. So the pie chart we can use, for example, here the subjects which we see, like other, sociology, economy, anthropology, and psychology. It means the percentages we have, no, the relative frequency distributions, we can visualize using the pie chart. Because from the 100% of this population, 9% of these students are selected other subjects, and 34% of the students are selected psychology students over the population. So that's what the pie chart we use. Okay. And to create the pie chart is very simple. I just survived dot plot kind of the pie plot. So we can plot this pie chart various ways, like plt.py. This function also used for creating the pie charts. We can use this function or you can say just the data frame dot plot. And the kind, that is pie, the y variable, it is count, because I'm just taking the frequency distribution table that I already created here, the survived table. No, this frequency table has labels like 0 and 1. Okay, so the frequency table I'm using for creating the pie chart. Okay. And autopact is nothing but the it is showing the percentages. No, so if I say 1.2f, that means two decimal points will be shown. Okay. If I say 1.1f, that will be one decimal point will be shown. Okay. Okay. So this is the pie chart. And okay, I think that's it. We'll wind up this session from this, because it's already 7:30 going to be. Okay, so we'll cover this summarization part tomorrow. So any doubts until this? So now again I will say, like, don't worry about these codes, because I will explain each and everything later sessions, because in the Python sessions, no, we'll cover all these codes. Just to explain the what it is, I'm just taking these codes. Okay. Any doubts?
Not for now, Irfan. Thanks.
Okay. Okay, I think we can wind up this session. So before that, I will just tell you, we are bigdatahandson.com. Our website is bigdatahandson.com. You know that. And this video will be uploaded maybe today itself. And you can see here the meetup uploads, meetup videos tab. You can see the videos. It takes some time to load, I think. Okay. And our YouTube channel also, bigdatahandson.com. If you subscribe, then you will get the latest updates. Okay. So data sets, you can, all the data sets you can find here. So which I'm using the data sets from this Kaggle website only. Okay. So don't worry about the data sets also. Just go through the Kaggle and type the name of the data set, you can find. Okay. These are also open source. Okay. This data is also open source. you can find that. Okay, thank you. We will see tomorrow.
See you tomorrow, Ipan. Thank you.
Thank you.